Do canoes, they have wood, sails or not?
That's a good question. I asked a man who studied with the Swedish anthropologists that same question, and he claims that his mentor, what is that fellow's name, that Heyerdahl, right, he claims that in his research that there were sails, because his replication had sails, right? So there are too many instances where the Haidas are proficient at sailing, and they make their sails from plaited cedar bark. They did, and so so that's a question up in the air, because there isn't that many early journalists who have mentioned sails, but they really were good at sailing when. With their cedar sails.
So there are sort of historic photographs of the 1880s, 1890s of on the coast of people canoes with the center mast and woven sails. But I don't know that anybody's found any pre-contact examples.
What's the difference between weaving up and weaving down? Which is easier? And isn't gravity what makes someone to start weaving down, which is more easy?
Well, I think it's easy weaving down because that's what I'm used to. But the majority of world cultures weave on more complicated looms. Even their simple looms, you're weaving up and you're pushing things up. And then after the twining, then came the plating, and you start working faster. I work with just my hands, and that's why it takes me 2.5 years to do a full-size rope. But weavers got faster by using the heddle and the shuttle. And so then the weaving up was the better way, and that keeping the warps taut. For that shuttle and heddle action, so it made things faster weaving up. So, but we have to keep things loose for us when we twine.
Mm-hmm. Evelyn, you mentioned that when you do fabrics, it's very much linked to basket weaving. Can you expand a bit on that as to the I mean, if an ordinary woven garment isn't usually described as being linked to a basket technique. So, what
you spoke
of the use of the cedar bark in the fabric itself. So
right. Well, before the wool came, these early robes and clothing were all made of cedar and pounded cedar. And so if you look at this hat, you start in the center here and you're weaving in one direction. So it's one directional weaving. And then because we've got our canoes, we have canoe capes that we would put over our head that had the opening, and how they were constructed was on a tripod pod. And so, again, weaving in one direction, right? So my mother and my daughter are in what they call the earliest weaving of textiles. The style is called now rapeskin. And those are all woven in one direction. And that's why there's all this fringe. So they start on the left, and they weave all the way across, and they tie off. And there's a fringe there, so then they add a fringe on the other side. So every line is separate to itself. It goes completely across one direction, tie off, jump over to the left, weave one direction. So it's very much a part of the twining in one direction that was part of the basketry and the cylindrical basketries and stuff. Well. There was a brilliant woman if this is a woman's art, that's why I say it's a brilliant woman. Brilliant Haida woman. Discovered that if you wove in the one direction and then turned around and made connections on color areas, interlocked joints, so you would weave in one direction, you'd connect, and then so the color areas were back and forth. And then you could create the form line. And it must have been so frustrating before that aha moment with the brilliant woman, because the earlier weaving, they were very geometric. And it must have been just frustrating for the Haida woman artists to see this beautiful flowing form line and then not have a technical ability to create that form line. But once they started weaving back and forth, then it was easier to create that form line. So that's how it evolved from our basketry. And we know that through the fact that old weave was one direction.
Is it clockwise or counterclockwise?
Left to right. Part of my traditional learning was learning about the indigenous dyes. So I know what created the hues, but I've done enough studies in museums and pulling out the drawers and realizing that there's so much fading from the sun and exposure with the indigenous dyes that I really want to. I take 2.5 years to do my project, and I want it to last a couple hundred years. So I try to use the best modern dyes, but I replicate the indigenous dyes.
The legend of the killer whale. Why the adjective killer?
I think that is a word that isn't an indigenous word, right? So we thought of them as spirit people, and some, if a person drowned, they were often repositories for the drowned person. So that is one of the beliefs with the spirit of the killer whale.
I've always been taught that the English name killer whale is actually a versal of the whalers would say whale killers. They're the animal that can actually attack the big baleen whales. They're hunters. That's what I was always taught.
But I understand too.
But that's the English name.
I wish I knew more about the Haida language than I do. It's the one thing that wasn't passed to me. My older sister has a high vocabulary, and she's a teacher of the language. And maybe that's the reason why, as a middle child, I've left her the language. But yes, I know that the name is very closely related to the spirit.
So in the video at the start, Robert Davidson was saying that the society was matrilineal. I don't know if that was the case in all the villages, and I see that through your own personal history, and that's all passed, the weaving and the traditions were passed through from your grandmother to your mother to yourself, and you're passing on to your daughters, etc. Is it still matrilineal? And
it is very matrilineal. Okay. Our clans come down from our mothers. We are who our mother is. But even the chiefs, like the chief, if he is thinking, who shall I pass my chieftainship down to, it's not usually his decision, from matriarch's decision. And there, it's dictated by tradition. It would be his sister's oldest son that would, it wouldn't be his son, because his son would be an opposite clan. Because in our culture, I'm eagle, and when I got to be a teenager, I was given a bracelet from my nanny, and it was an eagle bracelet. And the reason we would get that would be that any future suitor needs to know,
okay,
I'm eagle. And so if there was an eagle person interested in me, they couldn't be interested in me. It had to be a raven. So these identifying tests, like I say, are still used today. Recently there was a chief, he threw a feast. And it was a big feast, it was all busy. And I heard a thump. And here, a woman had fallen. And it turned out it was the chief's wife. The new chief's wife. And I was concerned, and then I looked around to the people who were around this woman, and it didn't look like she, from their faces, it didn't look like she was hurt, but nobody was picking her up. And then I saw the chief motioning to his nephews, he had some big nephews, so they went to pick her up. Nobody else reached out to pick her up, his big nephews were. And the reason why is if the opposite clan had helped her out, they would have owed that opposite clan a feast. So the chief was smart to motion his big nephews over to help her up. So there is tension between the eagles and the ravens. But the marriages keep us all in line.
And visiting anthropologists never help anybody. We never take trays. We just step back and make sure we don't get caught up.
Yeah, so it's a living tradition. Mm-hmm. And we remember our rules.
Can I ask, it's so fascinating how you, it's easy for you, you're ancient people, and it's so easy for you to speak for in centuries. You're talking about 200 years. It's so amazing because Greeks also have this great past. They know they're going to have a future of Hellenism. So.
Yes, and the Greeks worked with the stones, that they lived amongst the stones. And the Haidas did carve stones. But the majority of their art is the fibers and the wood. And so we don't have the thousands of years of work to remind us, where, because ours disintegrated in our very moist and wet rainforest. We don't have those reminders, but it was our stories that remind us, and our songs. And stories and songs were owned with clans. And but that very similar with the Greek people. There was their stories that we united them and identified with each other, their stories. And the songs and stories were important to us as well as to the Greek people, I believe. Yeah.
So do you still feel that your people have the strong bonds to continue? Even in an oral basis, because I understand this is all passed on verbally. Is it actually in writing also, or is it,
We're very lucky. We had some very learned people to help us take down our stories and our songs. There's a man, John Enrico, contemporarily has helped retain those elements, and early on in 1900 and 1901, John Swanton came, and he was brilliant. He was brilliant in choosing who helped him. He had future chief as a translator, and he went to traditional storytellers. He was a quiet young man, as far as I know, and I think that he was very smart in choosing his helpers. Mm-hmm. And they shared with him many stories, and so we're very fortunate to have this written down.
I've also been extraordinarily engaged in inviting all the elders, but also up in Massey, to a regular basis. The elders are all come together, or they're brought by family members, and they will sit for much of the morning and just speak in Haida, and that's just recorded. And people will talk about the words, and the words they know, and the words from their clan, and it's been recording. I mean, I think Mika started this about 20 years ago, and so there's this huge library tape of the remaining speakers. And very often, younger people will come in and they'll sit at the table just to learn and ask questions, and they'll bring in the kids from school. And so the whole community has invested in honoring these elders who still speak it, but are also just learning as quickly as they can. They have a lot of material.
Yes, and it's so important that that's happening, because we're a Haida language is what you call isolate. There's no near relative of this language. It stands alone, and so this effort is it's a race against time, because we're losing elders, and so it's wonderful that they're recorded. And I just hope money and funds and things continue to go into language preservation for the Haida, because I think it notes down the way we think. The Eskimos have how many words for snow? Well, the Haida people have as many words for the kind of rain we get in autumn.
And same for your craft works, and are they written down, or are they your techniques?
My mother's writing a book. Okay. My mother's writing a book, and she didn't want it to be a how-to book, because there's several books out that talk about techniques, but even she's 86, and like I said, my grandmother was born in the 1880s and was 96 when she passed away. So these stories of using basketry, like there were special baskets just for seaweed gathering, and there were special baskets just for seabird gathering. We'd gather the seabird eggs, so these all have special techniques and patterns. And my mother, as a child, would gather seabird eggs, and she remembers. There's stories, her personal stories of how these traditional objects were used personally by her. I think her book will be pretty interesting. She'll have some techniques, but it's close to being published.
You mentioned Boaz, the anthropologist. Has he studied the Haida?
Who is
Boaz, B-O-A-Z, Boaz.
Oh, yes. He studied Haidas. Mostly Boaz did a lot of the Simsion.
Boaz is famous for his Kwakwakwa collections, but he sent
Swanton
to work with the Haida. He sent others of his students, superiors, studied with each other. So grateful 100 years later that some of these things were kept available. And I'm using collections, but also archives, songs, and wax art recordings, and so on. We are constantly sending them into the community to dance groups and people at schools and other places, and we have a lot of visitors.
Yeah.